good day, everybody. Today we will look at the process of risk management. We have talked
about clubs association under GST. And to deliberate on the topic, we have a very learned person, Mr. Sujit Ghosh, Advocate Supreme Court. And he will take us through all the aspects related to this. I welcome him in today's Zoom meeting. Welcome, sir. Friends, the dispute on the taxability of supply of goods or provision of service by an association club to its members has been a perpetual one, be it under erstwhile regime of service tax or under GST regime. The main point of argument is whether an association and its members are distinct or are the same, and whether principle of mutuality is still hold good under the GST regime. Honorable Supreme Court, as you all know, in an recent judgment in Calcutta Club Limited and Ranchi Club Limited in October 2019, has held that service tax is not applicable on incorporated members' clubs on the ground that principle of mutuality, as laid down in Young Men's Indian Association, will apply to members' club and association. In this context, one question arises: whether refund of service tax already paid can be claimed as a refund now, and if yes, so whether an application needs to be filed for this or a writ is to be filed before the High Court, and if whether there is any time limitation for this. Can Section 7(1) of the CGST Act defines supply, and it integrally includes all forms of supply goods or services made by a person for a consideration in the course of furtherance of business. And as you know, the definition of business in Section 2, Subsection 17, includes provision by a club, association, society, or any such body for a subscription or any other consideration of the facilities or benefit to its members. So supply by a club, association, has been specifically covered under the definition of business. Consideration as defined in the CGST Act, read with Indian Contract Act, needs to flow from one person to another. Unlike service tax law, GST law doesn't deem an association and its member as distinct persons. Now the question is whether the principle of mutuality, as laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in Young Men's Indian Association, will apply to members' club association, and the transaction between the association and its members will not qualify as supply per se under GST. Further, because of retrospective changes made in the definition of supply by inserting subclause subsection 1A in Section 7, whereby whether Para 7 of Schedule 2, which deems supply of goods by an unincorporated association or body of persons to a member thereof for valuable consideration, whether it will be whether a supply of goods, whether it has become redundant now, that needs to be discussed. Friends, these are some pertinent issues which many of us, being a part of a members' club or association, are facing. And to deliberate on these topics, we have today Mr. Sujit Ghosh, a very learned person at the Supreme Court. I'll request him to throw light on these aspects. And before he commences his deliberation, I request Mr. Sanjay Poddar, our convener, to briefly introduce Mr. Ghosh. Over to Mr. Sanjay Poddar. Thank you.
Thank you, DS. Thank you. It's our privilege to introduce the speaker, learned speaker, Sri Sujit Ghosh, Advocate, Supreme Court of India and High Courts. Sujit is an advocate specializing in the tax matters and is based in New Delhi, India. Sujit qualified as a lawyer from the National Law School of India, University of Bangalore in 1995 and has 25 years of experience in tax laws. He started his career with Arthur Edison in 1995 in the indirect tax practice of the said Big Five international accounting firms until his global dissolution in 2002. Thereafter, in 2002, Sujit joined the Ernst & Young in their indirect tax practice and was inducted into their senior management and group head team. In 2004, he went on to set up a boutique tax consultation firm by the name BMR Advisor and was one of the founding indirect tax partner there. In 2010, he founded BMR Legal and shifted his professional trajectory from tax consulting to tax litigation. And in 2013, helped the BMR Legal to set up the Adivator Legals at Boutique Tax Litigation Firm and was the national head of the said firm for over 5 years until the end of January 2019. Thereafter, at the end of the 2019 January, he demitted office at the Adivator Legal to set up his own independent chamber practice by the name of Chambers of Sujit Ghosh, and has been the operating acting as an independent arguing counsel for his clients and also as a counsel representing clients of Big Four accounting firms, other accounting firms and law firms. In these years as a tax litigator, Sujit has been acting as an arguing tax counsel in area of indirect taxation, that is GST, as also earlier law, custom DGFT and also the constitution law. He has several landmark decisions to his credit on indirect tax and income tax matters. As a accommodation and knowledge shares, he is a regular speaker at various industry fora, including FICCI, CII, SOCAM, US India Business Council, India National Bar Association, American Bar Association, AIFTP, Tax Sutra, India Infrastructure, Independent Power Producer Associations, and so on. He is also a regular resource person for the past many years in National Judicial Academy, Bhopal, and delivers classroom lecture to high court judges from across the country on tax, constitution law, and also the administrative laws. Accolades and recognition. In the past few years, he has been conferred with the many following accolades, listed among the top indirect tax leader in the India by World Tax Publisher ITR 2019, listed among the top 100 lawyers of India by India Business Law Journal for the year 2018-19, tax lawyer for the year 2017-18 Legal Era 16-17 and 2016-17 Indian National Bar Association, listed as one of the leading tax litigators of India by the International Tax Review for consecutive years from 2013 to 2018. He is recognized as a ranked lawyer by the Chambers and Partners, and he has been shortlisted in the category of Tax Litigation Dispute Practice Leader of the Year for ITR Asia Tax Award 2016. And with this, I request our learned speaker today, Advocate Sujit Ghosh, to please proceed his deliberation. We welcome him. Sir, please start your deliberation.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
One formality I forget to share with you. This is for you, sir. This pandemic, we cannot share with actual bouquet, so we are sharing it with you.
This is creative. Thank you so much. This is so thoughtful.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate.
Thank you, sir.
So thank you all of you for having joined today. It's a Saturday afternoon and it's a leisurely time. Good time to have a conversation around something that titillates our intellectual space. I think Mr. Agarwala has kind of laid out the remit of our conversation today. He has very succinctly brought out the nuances and the issues that needs to be considered under GST insofar as transactions of a club, members club, etc. is concerned. So what I have for you today is a slide deck, which is basically divided into three parts. The first part is to familiarize you with the very notion of mutuality of interest, how it has evolved from the English law, how it was accepted by the Indian judiciary under income tax, how it was extended from income tax to sales tax and service tax. So that's part one. Part two is essentially to tell you about what is happening across the country under GST, because there are a multitude of advanced rulings that have come about, some good, some bad, some fair, some unfair. Whatever they may have happened, it's basically a summary of all that is happening on the ground level. Part three is going to be what is the real issue for people dealing with this aspect, whether the refund can be claimed, whether it is at all applicable, how do you deal with it, should you go to the writ court, should you need to do anything else, and all of those things and more. So there are three parts. And how much time do I have? I'll accordingly marshal my time accordingly. If you can just tell me how much time you have.
Well, 1.5 hours, sir.
Okay, fine. So let me, without much ado, let me quickly take you to my presentation and start with that. Okay. So the evolution, the very doctrine of mutuality of interest, this is no rocket science. You need to understand that in normal world, when you deal with people and you deal with and you carry out commercial transactions on which there is a charge of tax of whatever nature, a commercial transaction can be carried out only between two separate parties. 2%, so to say, because after all these commercial transactions are contracts. And contract requires, you know, two separate legal entities having contracting ability. They are major and not minor. There must be a consideration and all of that and more. Which means you need two parties to be involved or two legal persons to be involved for any contract to come into existence. And mutuality of interest is all about when transactions which seemingly appear to have been done between two separate parties are essentially being seen to be done by the same party, which means fundamentally you cannot carry out business with yourself. Fundamentally, you cannot sell goods to yourself. Fundamentally, you cannot supply services to yourself. Now, when the yourself is the same legal entity, for the longest time, we have never had any concern. For those of you who come from the income tax era, you'll remember the famous judgment of, in the case of Marshall's case, where in case of demerger, merger, you know, it was very clearly brought out. And it also happens under sales tax. It's happened under sales tax that unless the legal entity is any different, you cannot be said to be carrying out a commercial transaction. That is where, you know, the legal entity is very clearly ascertainable as two juristic person, as the same juristic person. But when it comes to clubs, let us understand how those clubs are. There are fundamentally two kinds of club. One are club which are known as proprietor club. So you and I could decide we will have a club and we'll call for members from whom we'll take some fees, right of admission reserved, and they need not partake in any of the proceeds of what happens. They have no vested right nor any interest with respect to the assets and liabilities of that particular club. We are not talking about those proprietary clubs. So keep that in mind. The discussion is only with respect to members club. So what happens in a members club? Essentially, a members club is a club made by the member, for the member and by the member, which means people come together, they contribute for a common purpose, for a common cause, and whatever is the corpus of that particular membership and whatever is the property that is created by that membership belongs to the members themselves. This is a very, very important point that needs to be brought in mind, that even though multiple people come together, make some contributions, that contribution leads to creation of a corpus and a property, the ownership rights or the proprietary rights over whatever is created through that corporation, that corpus, is essentially owned equally by the members. Now, members may come and go. You know, today we may have 10 members, tomorrow it could be 12 members, tomorrow, day after it could be 9 members. But notwithstanding the addition, deletion of the members, the very basic status of the ownership remains the same, i.e. those who are in the helm of affairs, holding themselves out as the members, having contributed it, they have a right over whatever the corpus and the property of that particular association is. Under that circumstances, the entire jurisprudence from the common law has always held that the member and the so-called creature that they have created, which is the association or the club, are no different person. They are one and the same. In as much as the identity of the members and the association is one and the same, which means they have the same identity, so to say. And as such, therefore, you cannot be making a supply of services, or you cannot be said to be transactioning or carrying on a business. You cannot be said to be transferring goods inter se between the member and the association, because the identity of the two is one and the same. This has been the defining proposition of law, hallowed by time, and that proposition has been accepted across the globe in various jurisprudence, various jurisdictions, to say that whenever there is a transaction that takes place between the association and the member or vice versa, the transaction is not between two separate persons. The transaction is essentially between the same person in that sense. Okay. The very concept of such transaction is nothing but it's a self-supply, if I were to use the word, it's a self-supply, a supply to yourself, which is not tainted with any commerciality. Because you're not doing the transaction for any profit or gain. You're doing the transaction or you're doing the various activities only for yourself. That's the broad connotation of what mutuality of interest as such is, a mutuality as such is. So what we have is in front of you, the Australian Tax Office, which is very similar to what we have, the CBDT or CBEC equivalent. What they say is, and you have it in front of your slide, I'll quickly read it out for your consumption. The principle provides that where a number of persons contribute to a common fund created and controlled by them for a common purpose, any surplus arising from the use of that fund for the common purpose is not an income. And this, therefore, is the defining concept. Now, what they have also alluded to in doing, in putting this characterization is what you have in the third and the fourth bullet point. The principle requires complete identity between the members and the club, which means the members and the club are the same identity. There is no distinction in identity in their conduct, in their operation, in their behavior, in their rights, in their privileges. Okay, they are one and the same. And the club and the members are therefore have the same identity, the contributors and the beneficiaries being the same person. Okay, another characteristics that that they have also brought to fore is that the transaction between members and the association is not tainted with commerciality. Now, commerciality is very, very important. In other words, nobody is doing a transaction inter se between them, i.e. the association is not doing any transaction with the members with the purpose of earning a profit. The whole purpose is I am serving myself. There is a common pool of money. That common pool of money is being deployed for the benefit of each of the members who are participants to that particular fund, and therefore there is no commerciality to the whole concept. So the reason I'm trying to stress on this point is, in the context of GST, whenever anybody comes to you as tax advisors, consultants, and say, why can't we apply or can we apply the Supreme Court decision? I think the first and foremost task that you have to get on to is to find out the substance of the arrangement inter se that has been agreed to, or the charter of that association that has been created, in terms of what is the object and purpose. Is it a case that there is a commonality of interest and purpose? Is it a case that there is a contribution that is being made and the beneficiary of those contribution is the person who has actually contributed? Or are there characteristics that kind of taint the single identity feature? Or are there transactions that the association carries out which taints the commerciality, lack of commerciality test? This is a question of fact. And the reason I'm making this point is, there was a point that was made that should we go to the writ court, should we not go to the writ court, and so on and so forth. In my view, this is a mixed question of law and fact. Somebody will have to adjudicate whether or not the fact pattern of a given association, in the circumstances that has been brought to the notice of the tax authorities, actually satisfies these two preconditions. Because if these preconditions are merely suggested or pleaded, that is not good enough. Somebody will have to go through the arrangements and affairs and the documentation and the contracts or whatever else you may have to justify and substantiate that, yes, the test of complete identity stands satisfied because of ABCD reason, and B, that the transactions are not tainted with commerciality. Until and unless these two facts are without an iota of doubt, any application of the Supreme Court decision or any application of the mutuality of interest will be premature. It will be possible for the courts to say that as a writ court, I will not sit in judgment and examine contested facts that have not been adjudicated upon. So please keep in mind, whoever is harboring this thought that now that we have the Supreme Court decision, can we straight away go to the writ court, or can we straight away take on the tax office by going to the writ court, we'll have to go through this muster, go through this test of having an ascertained finding insofar as complete identity and insofar as non-tainting with commerciality is concerned. So that's the first point I want to make. Now, British Tax Encyclopedia, which is of 1962 edition, kind of brings out this concept in greater detail. And I'll read out what they have to say on this concept of mutuality so that the concept is very clear in your mind. What they say, they actually go on to explain this completeness of identity, you know, in the context of mutuality. And I'll read it for your consumption. In several early cases, there were dicta to the effect that a man could not make a profit by trading with himself, which is what I also alluded to at the beginning. This developed into the proposition that when persons contribute to a common fund in pursuance of a scheme for their mutual benefit, having no dealings or relations with any outside body, they cannot be said to have made a profit when they find they have overcharged themselves and that some portion of their contribution may be safely refunded. It has also been established that the same principle applies although the contributors incorporate themselves into a separate entity to carry out the mutual scheme. Now keep in mind, in the same statement of British Tax Encyclopedia, they're talking about two separate kind of situation. One where it is incorporated, one where it is not incorporated. They're dealing with both. Okay. So the latter part of what they say is in respect of the incorporated ones. I read, it has also been established that in the same principle applies, although the contributors incorporate themselves into a separate entity to carry out the mutual scheme, and the surplus contributions are put to reserve and not immediately returned. For this doctrine to apply, it is essential that all the contributors to the common fund are entitled to participate in the surplus and that all the participants in the surplus are contributors, so that there is complete identity between contributors and the participators. This means identity as a class, so that at any given moment of time, the person who are contributing are identical with the person entitled to participate. It does not matter that the class may be diminished by persons going out of the scheme or increased by others coming in. So in short, therefore, the crux and the very, 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 fundamental concept of mutuality is that there should be a complete identity between the members and the association. They should not be tainted with commerciality. The surplus should be something on which everybody should have a right. There is no intent of commerciality between the members and the association. And if these features are there, only then can you say it has a mutuality of interest exists. Now, the first of the time when this issue was considered by the Indian courts was in this judgment of 1997. Of course, Young India was also there. So in this case, what they brought out is a further nuance to that. Basically, what they said that, whenever there is a club which offers, let's say, a refreshment or some kind of benefit, okay, and all of that is rendered in exchange for an admission fee or subscription fee or whatever you may call it, and basis that certain usual privileges and advantages and convenience, facilities, etc. are granted, it can be safely assumed that it is not done with a profit motive. Okay, so this becomes a fulcrum for you to make a presumption on the essential attribute of most members club arrangement. Okay, that should there be an admission fee or subscription fee which is charged across the board to all the members and everybody is entitled to the same and identical privileges, same and similar privileges, irrespective of caste, color, creed, etc. and there are no classification or sub-classification inter se between them, then you can say for sure that whatever the club is carrying out, the current club is not carrying out with the intent of profit or making of a profit. Okay. But then at the same breath, Supreme Court also went about making another statement. Supreme Court said that not only if we have a situation where not only the members but also third parties who are not members, if they are also eligible for the same kind of benefits, then you can certainly have a case where the profit motive comes out, because then you are not making a distinction between members and non-members. So what is important, and again, I go back to my original statement, whether or not a particular members club meets with the primary precondition to qualify under this mutuality interest is a question of fact. In deciding and ascertaining whether that complete identity is established or not, or that the it is not tainted with commerciality, you'll also have to look at whether or not such association deals with third parties. And when dealing with third parties, whether or not same or similar benefits have been rendered to the third parties. And if they are actually rendering the same or similar benefits and privileges and services to the third parties, then it may be difficult for you to hold a view that the mutuality of interest precondition stands satisfied. So be careful. We have to therefore examine each club on its own merits, on its own conduct. We will have to examine based on their charter and what has been done in the previous many years insofar as their conduct of their operations are concerned. That's the second point I wanted to make. Now, the earliest of the decision under in the British law, the English law, was the Glasgow Corporation 1875 judgment. They laid down the following three, four tests. Okay. It is an association of people called members. There is a common cause. Every member makes his contribution, and the aim of the activity is not to earn profits or gain. So these are the four preconditions that way back in 1875 that the English law had kind of evolved. And by and large, in a members club, these four points will always stand satisfied. There is absolutely never a difficulty, subject, however, to those deviations I just spoke a little while back. Gough versus Evans was the landmark judgment which kind of brought out this whole issue into the fore, okay, where it was an issue of provision of liquor by the club to its members, and the question for determination was whether that qualified at the retail sale, because the regulations pertaining to retail sales would have warranted some onerous obligation and so on and so forth. And it is in that context that the courts, or the Queen's Bench, gave his ruling that the members are joint owners of the property. Therefore, the rightful receiver of such goods being contributors to the common fund. In other words, what they said was whatever is owned by the association is essentially owned by the members themselves. Members don't have any independent existence outside and dehorse that of the association. Okay. So members, they jointly own the property, and it is, if it is being consumed, then it is, the consumption is by the person who owns it. And therefore, it also went about holding that whether or not you charge more or less the same price, or whether it's more or less, it really does not matter, because it is actually a transaction with self. It does not alter the character at all. This principle was kind of further amplified in the Triborne Working Men's Club, which was a 1940 King's Bench judgment. They followed Graff and Evans, and then they went on to say that members owned the liquor between themselves, and there could never be a sale between them. And the club was simply a trustee or agent. Now, mark my word, and I repeat, the club was held to be a trustee or agent of the member holding the liquor for and on behalf, and not antagonistic to its members. In short, what they said, and this is very important for the purpose of GST, and I'll tell you why a little while from now. In short, what they submitted was, or what they found, what they concluded was, the association and the member, they have the same identity. But the association effectively, therefore, is holding the property in trust as an agent of each of the members. So the association does not have any independent identity dehors of the members, but acting as an agent or a trustee, okay, of the members. Keep this word in mind, agent or a trustee. It will come back. I'll come back to this point in terms of relevance little later. Okay. Now, the Indian context, the first tax issue that came about was Young Men's Association. I think many of us are aware of that. Basically, the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court laid down this three character that, in respect of, they said there are three kinds of clubs. The first is those that are incorporated under Section 26, which is now Section 8 companies under the new law. Second are societies registered with the Societies Registration Act. And third, which are formed by execution of a trustee. Now, these are the three forms through which in which this mutuality as a concept can permeate. Okay, it doesn't necessarily have to be a society registered under society side. It can be a company, it can be by a trust, whichever legal document or legal mode you may choose doesn't really matter. What matters is, are you coming together and contributing together for a common purpose or not? That is what matters. Now, the mode of creation really does not matter. That's the point I'm trying to make here. Okay. And they went on to hold that there is no liability of sales tax on supply of food and other such articles by the clubs to its member. Now, keep in mind, this was a decision prior to the 46th Constitution Amendment, prior to the deemed sale as a concept, which was introduced subsequent to Ganandakali and all of that. Okay. Because that judgment, that those amendments happened sometime in 1986 or so, okay, 1982, okay, the 46th Amendment. And this judgment is of 1970. So this is a pre-constitution amendment deemed sale concept where they went about to say that under these circumstances, there is no question of any sale that can be said to have taken place. Now, the last bullet point again is very, very important. It was held that there could be no sale in the above case since there is no transfer of property from one person to other. Since the members club is an agent making available the property belonging to his member based on principle of mutuality. So the Supreme Court once again in 1970 goes on to hold that the association is an agent of the members. Okay, keep this in mind. I go back to the previous slide. Okay, Claybong's judgment of the King's Bench of 1940. Okay, they also said the same thing, and I'm reading it for your benefit again. The court held that as the members owned the liquor between themselves, there was no actual sale, and the club was simply a trustee or an agent of the member holding the liquor. So the Claybong's judgment of 1940 King's Bench was adopted in many ways by the Supreme Court in Young Men's Association to go on to hold that the association or the club that we are speaking about are essentially nothing but an agent holding the property for or on behalf of the members who are the principals. Okay. And there is a reason why I'm harping on this agent for some reason, which I'll tell you later. So just keep this in mind. Two decisions, King's Bench decision of the days of yore 1940, as well as Supreme Court 1970, goes on to hold that association or a club is essentially an agent of the member. We move further up. Then we have the next judgment, which was the Madras Race Club, which was Commissioner of Income Tax, and they very clearly brought out the following three preconditions for your consideration. Mutuality, principle of mutuality is not destroyed by the presence of transaction with or profit derived from non-members. Now, this is a significant departure. Please keep this in mind. Saying that even if the association may be doing transactions with non-members, merely because they're doing this with the non-members does not mean that the concept of mutuality stands diluted or obliterated. Now, this is a departure, especially in the context of the earlier proposition of law, which I had just read out. I'll just take you back to that particular slide. Okay. Okay. The decision of Supreme Court in Bankipur. Second bullet point. Okay, 1997. If the object is to carry on a particular business and money is realized both from the members and from non-members for the same consideration by giving the same or similar benefits to all alike, the dealings as well as whole disclose the same profit earning motives and are all alike tainted with commerciality, thus the principle in such situation cannot apply. So keep in mind the 1997 decision of Supreme Court said that when you are dealing with third parties, and they put a caveat, and while dealing with the third parties, you are giving them identical benefits and privileges, then the tainted with commerciality test gets satisfied and you will not be able to pass the muster of mutuality of interest. Now, the earlier decision of Supreme Court, okay, which was in the case of Madras Race Course, there they stopped at saying that even if merely because you're doing transaction with the third party, it does not taint. So assimilation and synthesis of this two proposition of law would therefore mean two things. A, mutuality of interest between members and the association or the club can continue to be said to exist even if you may be transacting with the third party. However, If in transaction with the third party, you are giving them identical privileges and benefits and services, then by virtue of the subsequent decision of the Supreme Court in Bankipur, it will become a case where the mutuality of interest test is not being satisfied. Now, I go back to my original point that I mentioned, that these are mixed question of fact and law. These questions of facts will have to be adjudicated or will have to be established or will have to be no doubt admitted by both the revenue and yourselves, such that nobody can stand up before a court of law and say that we don't know whether mutuality test stands satisfied or not, because we really haven't seen the P&L of the company or the balance sheet of the company or what they do. There are hundreds and hundreds of transactions that the club or association has been doing over the period of time. Unless some amount of diligence is being done, how can we be sure that the mutuality test stands satisfied? And as soon as these disputed question of facts are raised before a writ court, the outcome is very clear. They will ask you to go back and get the adjudication done. So while we may have the decision of Supreme Court in the Calcutta Club's case, but that decision is only a point of law. But the factum of whether or not those factual attributes exist in different cases in different associations club will have to be labored and established, should be an admitted state of affairs. And if it is contentious, then you have a difficulty there. Okay, we move further up. The next judgment was that of Bangalore Club, where they kind of reiterated the whole concept again, and I'll just read it out for your consumption. There should be complete identity between contributors and participators. The members have a right of disposal over the surplus. Whether trade or activity is mutual, the fact that as regards certain activities, certain members only take advantage of the facilities offered does not affect the mutuality of the enterprise. Meaning thereby, let's say there is a swimming pool facility. There are 100 members, but only 10 of them are using it. And the 90 people are not using it. But merely because 90 people are not using it will not taint the mutuality concept at all. So long as the swimming pool is available to everybody who is a member, regardless of how many people may be actually using it, the test of mutuality will stand satisfied. Okay, that's what the third bullet is. Where the trade or activity is mutual, the fact that as regards certain activities, certain members only take advantage of the facilities offered does not affect the mutuality of the enterprise. Members clubs are an example of mutual undertaking, but where a club extends facilities to non-members, to that extent, the element of mutuality is wanting. Now, this is the third attribute that comes out after the earlier judgment of Bankipur. So, first of the decisions I put in, where they said that if same privilege or equal privileges are given to third party, mutuality does not exist. B, the principle was even if you give it to the third party, the members part of what you are giving is not tainted. It cannot be said to be that the test of mutuality cannot be said to be not satisfied. And the third attribute that they said that wherever you are giving to a third party, that aspect of what you are giving to the third party, there the mutuality test does not stand satisfied. But that does not mean that the remainder part where you are giving it to the members, the mutuality test is not satisfied. Now, you may have all kinds of members club, all kinds of club, where the club may have a pro shop, may be selling things to not only members but also third parties. Third parties could be those guests that may be coming in, or anybody, any walking, I don't know. Different clubs may have different rules of engagement. Every such activity that the club does will have to necessarily be mapped. All of these exceptions that these various decisions have kind of held will have to be isolated and identified. To the extent those transactions do not meet the test of mutuality, namely with the third parties, and if there are such transactions, you cannot take a position that I will take advantage of the Supreme Court decision in Calcutta Club. All those cases will have to be insulated and isolated, and appropriate tax needs to be discharged as a going in position. Or you have to make sure that those transactions do not have any bearing or an interference in the substantive mutuality concept with regard to the transaction between the association and the members. That is a question of diligence. That's a question of fact finding that each one of you will need to do insofar as your clients are concerned. Each of the firms and each of the association and clubs, etc., will need to necessarily do at the back end and be ready with the data point. Okay. Now, we now go to the Calcutta Club judgment. Now, intervening period before the Calcutta Club judgment, And after the Young Men's Association judgment, the Constitution of India was amended. And Article 366-29A was introduced. Subclause F was introduced specifically in respect of this. And I'm reading subclause F. Tax on sale or purchase of goods includes a tax on the supply by way of or as part of any service. Tax on supply of goods by any unincorporated association or body of person to a member thereof for cash, deferred payment, or other valuable consideration. When this amendment was introduced, it appears that the assumption that the government of India, the legislator of the day, had made that incorporated associations and unincorporated associations are at two different footing. They felt that unincorporated associations needs to be deemed they assume that transaction between members and unincorporated associations would need to be deemed to be transaction between two separate person, and therefore the amendment, as if transactions between incorporated association and its member was always deemed to be taxable. Okay, keep this in mind. They interpreted or they misinterpreted or interpreted the Young Men's decision to probably believe that whenever there was an incorporated association and a transaction between such incorporated association and the person or the members, because they are two juristic person and therefore the transaction of sale can be said to exist and mutuality as a concept need not be met, cannot be met. And only where it was an unincorporated association and it was a transaction with its members was the need or was a case fit for a mutuality of interest. And therefore those transactions were escaping the net of tax and therefore they wanted to deem it to be taxable. So the issue that came up before Supreme Court Calcutta Club, one of the first issues that came up for consideration was this constitutional amendment or the concept of mutuality. Is it restricted only to unincorporated and its members, or does it apply to incorporated and its member as well? And the Supreme Court made a very clear statement that I think the government of India, the legislature of the day, has misread or misinterpreted the decision of the Supreme Court in Young Men's case. Nowhere in Young Men's case did the Supreme Court ever say that when it comes to incorporated association and its member, mutuality concept does not exist. But wherever it is between unincorporated and its member, mutuality exists. Nowhere did the Supreme Court ever say that. And if the government was harboring a wrong belief and wrong notion to that extent, and therefore in Calcutta Club's case, Supreme Court said, whether it is incorporated or it is unincorporated, it really does not matter. Because at the end of the day, the test is not of the juristic status or the modus in which you create the entity, whether by way of a trust deed, whether by way of a society, whether by way of a Section 8 company, really does not matter. What matters is whether multiple people came together, contributed for a common purpose, such that the identity of what they have created and respectively each one of them is one and the same. That is the test. The test is not whether the created entity is a legal entity or not. So therefore, that's the first and foremost thing that they went about establishing. The second point they went about talking about is that, look, consideration in the context of sales tax, or whichever, say, you go back to Section 2D of the Contract Act, it necessarily requires two parties, two person. As I said, competent to contract should be major. Okay. Consensus addendum, reciprocal promises, all of these consensus addendum, reciprocal promises, a promise enforceable by an agreement, enforceable by law, the contract of that, all of that presupposes that the transaction is between two person. And when one application of mutuality test, it comes about that there are no two person, it's a single identity. Okay. Then you cannot say that there is a consideration that gets exchanged between the two supposedly or alleged two person, because there are no two persons. Okay. And then they therefore went in to say that, look, under these circumstances, there can be no question of sales tax that can ever be charged in a members club arrangement, qua the goods and goods that may be supplied by the association or a club to its member, whether it's food item or whatever else, and therefore notwithstanding 366.29AE or specific insertion of 366.29AE, such transaction cannot be subject to tax because the fundamental element for sales tax, namely consideration, is wholly missing. And under that circumstances, clearly no charge of tax can be created. It also had the benefit of looking at the service tax angle, because Ranchi Club matter had also come about before the Supreme Court. And they went on to say exactly the same thing, that an incorporated club does not become an entity different from its member by virtue of incorporation. This is what they clarified very clearly. There is no commerciality when the club renders services to its members. Since the club and members are one and the same, there are no two persons, i.e. a promisor and a promisee, who enter into a contract for a consideration. Net-net, therefore, whether for sales tax or for service tax, for want of consideration or for want of two persons competent to contract who can exchange a consideration for a reciprocal promise, the Supreme Court went about saying that there can be neither a service tax nor a sales tax. This is what they went about saying. So that's the jurisprudential evolution of this whole mutuality of interest concept under the Indian sales tax, service tax, and income tax realm. Now, thereafter, another decision came about, which was Yum Restaurants, and I think we did not labor that. You can read it. I'm just skipping this because basically they went on to state the same thing, that there should be commonality of interest and purpose and identity and all of that thing. So we can skip it. Now, once GST came about, sadly, and this is my personal comment, sadly, people choose to go to the authority of advance ruling, even though such authorities have failed the nation. They have failed the nation in adjudicating fairly for various and multitude of reasons. I did not get into that. That could be a point of discussion for some other time. But they have failed the nation in fair adjudication of some of these complex issues. But nevertheless, people have gone to the advance ruling authorities for reasons best known to them and have suffered significantly on multiple fold. And if I take a dipstick, probably 99% of the advance rulings have gone against the SSE and in favor of the revenue. Such has been the track record of the AIR ruling. But be that as it may, on this very issue of clubs, several people have taken recourse to the advance ruling forum. Some may have gone because they wanted to get a position clear so that they don't want to tomorrow a dispute. Doesn't matter if it is held to be taxable because they have a document from the government or an adjudicating authority which they can flash and recover the tax. Some may have gone hoping and aspiring that if it is negative, I'll take that to the High Court. Some may have gone for various others. So multiple people may have multiple reason and motive why they have gone. But what has happened is, the jurisprudence on mutuality of interest has in the process been killed. We had a fine judgment from the Supreme Court in the form of Calcutta Club. People had toiled hard to build it. And we have killed that jurisprudence before it could be even taken before a court through a regular process of litigation. Because the sweep of all of these AIR rulings that we see is completely, completely contrary to what the laws are. Okay, so I will take one after the other. First of the one was Lions Club of Pune. Okay, this what they did was they went to the AIR authorities in respect of collection of fees for pooling of funds to conduct social activities. These funds were also collected to organize seminars for leadership development, etc., etc. Okay, and the question was posed. Now the way the questions were posed was also very, very significant. So they posed a question before the AIR whether the company, whether the club should register under GST since there is no furtherance of business in its activity. Neither any services are rendered nor any goods are being traded. Now the double AIR, they looked at the definition of business. Okay. Now as we saw earlier in our conversation, that the definition of business, if I look at it in isolation, it clearly brings into the fore any transaction of an association or a club. Okay, So they looked at the definition of business to hold that since the activities of the club involve conducting social and charitable activity, it is not providing facilities or benefits to them. Okay, they said that that's fair. But when it went to the appellate authority, they kind of reversed it. The appellate authority went on to hold that activities of the club of providing leadership development seminars qualified as supply of service for a consideration. Why did they say that? Did they not know that there is a concept of mutuality that does not exist here? Okay, there is a mutuality of interest and therefore there is no, you cannot be a consideration for the same person. They go on to say, and look at the myopic approach. They go on to say, look at the definition of person under 284. The definition of person has two separate categories, individuals and association. Therefore, they make a presumption that they are two separate legal entities, two separate persons. Now, how daft can they be? And I'm using such strong words because the definition of person under GST Act is no different from the definition of person as it existed in the erstwhile law. You look at any legislation, General Clauses Act or whatever you may pick it up, there is always a legal person or a person will always include juristic person and living beings as well. Notwithstanding such segregation as it used to be there in the erstwhile era, the courts went about seeing through the transaction and coming to the substantive aspect of mutuality. And the AAAR in this case, for some strange reason, for obvious reasons, I'll put it, went about saying that merely because they have been slotted as two different persons under the definition of 284, the pretest of supply stands satisfied. How unfair can that judgment be? Be that as it may, we move to the subsequent one. Rotary Club of Mumbai, again, this was an AR where the issue was amount collected as membership subscription and admission fees for members. They wanted to ask a question on that. The club is an unincorporated association of members. That was the fact. Organized in the form of not-for-profit. Those features were also present. AR held an affirmative stating that the case was comparable to the Lions Club. Now, comparable to the Lions Club insofar as the AAAR ruling is concerned, in respect to which AAAR Maharashtra has already ruled. The AAAR, however, reversed the above, holding the description of the activities of the Rotary Club also did not qualify them under the definition of term business. Despite advancing whatever submission that they did, neither the AR or AAAR made observations regarding the principle of mutuality. For some reason, they were skirting that. They have been skirting, and that has been the pattern that if you raise some of this fundamental point, they are skirting that particular point and going basically into the definition clause of the statute and somehow trying to cover you within the net. So that is what happened there. Then Apsara, same fit, that was made. The AR held that the activity qualified as a supply since the definition was an inclusive one and not an exhaustive one. And the nature of applicants' activities qualified as a service to the member. So what were they doing? It was a case of a cooperative society which collected charges as per the their own bylaws, okay, to meet the objects. Okay. This money that they were collecting from the members for whatever objective that the bylaws had, they said that it is a consideration. It's complete departure. Complete departure. It's actually saying that no matter what the Supreme Court jurisprudence may be, no matter what the Supreme Court may have held, we as advanced ruling authorities are sui generis and we hold appropriate authority to kind of tacitly overrule whatever Supreme Court may have said. That is the fate of our country today. Be that as it may, this is your AR in the case of Apsara. Then there was something that happened on banking codes. I'm not getting to the details. These details are all there. I'll skip this. We come to Bengal. Okay, Wheels Club. Now, very convoluted way of dealing with this particular issue. They went about, the AAAR went about saying that there is no difficulty, there is no problem in the decision that was rendered by the AAAR and what the AAAR had held. They looked at the meaning of the word business under 217 of the GST Act. And because under the definition of business, okay, there is a specific mention that activities of a association or a member firm, etc., will be treated as a business. They went on to say that the test of business stands satisfied and therefore it is taxable. Now, I am told, and while I don't know for sure, I'm told this AAAR is pending before the High Court by way of a writ petition. I don't know. I was just told by somebody. I can stand corrected if somebody tells me otherwise. But be that as it may be, this order, the whole very logic adopted by the AR or the AAAR is absolutely a suspect and cannot even be sustained on a perusal of the basic law laid down by the Supreme Court. Then the Bengal Rowing Club was the subsequent one, which also went about the issue that they asked for consideration was privileges and amenities in the form of swimming facilities, gymnasium, indoor games, etc. That what was contended that this was a members club, it was not a proprietary club. They applied the concept of mutuality, but both the ARs and AAAR did not follow that. They did not apply the mutuality test, and they basically said that sorry, it is liable to tax. Sadly, very, very sad in terms of that. And there are many other AR, I'm skipping all of that, it's a matter of detail. So what is therefore coming out in the light of all that we discussed until now is that there is a set of law, there is a set of jurisprudence that has been laid out for the longest time by the British courts, English courts, as well as the Indian court. There is a set of conduct, there is a set of tests, and there is a set of threshold requirements that have been laid out, which is all based on facts. If those facts exist, then the conclusion of law is X. In a situation where those facts stand satisfied, then in my mind, it is very clear that any ruling that has gone contrary to that particular point of law laid down by the Supreme Court, notwithstanding GST, is wholly incorrect. Okay, because at the end of the day, the concept of sale is what we have in the supply. Concept of service is what we have in a supply, because what used to be sale and service separately is nothing but a supply today. What used to apply therefore then need necessarily have to be applied now, because the meaning of the word consideration under the GST law is no different in substance. Is no different in substance, because the meaning of the word consideration under the GST law also talks about reciprocal promises in lieu of or to induce. Okay. So all of that concept of 2D of the section 2D of the Indian Contract Act has been completely imbibed into the concept of consideration under the GST Act. And therefore, there's no reason why a different view need to be taken. But there are some thorny issues which we will talk about in this part of the so. So we saw that section 7.1, which is the business. Okay, I'm sorry, 7.1, which is the charging section. The definition section of what is a supply talks about, it should be made for a consideration in the course of furtherance of business. Consideration is defined to mean payment made or to be made in respect of, in response to, or for the inducement of a supply of services or both, whether by the recipient or any other person. So therefore, clearly consideration presupposes the existence of two persons. Clearly, there is no doubt about that, because somebody has to be there on the other side of the fence who is getting induced, who is making a response, who is actually tendering the monies in respect of something that the other person may have promised, which clearly therefore means that there has to be two separate persons in a transaction for a transaction to have the feature of a consideration. Okay. Business, however, has been defined to mean, to include provision by a club of the facilities or benefits to its member. Now, this is very subtle. What they have therefore done is that whenever a club or a members club in that context does any activity with its members, it is deemed to be a business. But business alone cannot trigger a tax liability. Mainly because you are carrying on business alone cannot trigger a tax liability unless there is a consideration. Because section 9, which is your charging section, specifically says tax shall be levied on intrastate supplies. Intrastate supplies has been defined to include, to mean supply for a consideration carried in furtherance of a business. So even though you may be carrying on whatever in furtherance of a business, unless consideration can be said to exist, the charge of tax cannot apply. And if the consideration definition, as has been seen in the GST Act, presupposes existence of two persons, then by application of mutuality of interest clause or a concept, mutuality between the member and the association, you can always say that there are no two persons, and therefore for the limited purposes there cannot be any consideration, because I cannot sell goods to myself, I cannot provide services to myself in that concept. Okay, so this is very important. Now, what is equally important to remember is that we have section 7 entry 7A, 7 of Schedule 2, which says that supply of goods by an unincorporated association or body of person to a member thereof for cash, deferred payment, or valuable consideration is deemed to be a supply of goods. Fortunately, Schedule 2 now has become a schedule for classification, because after Section 7(1)(a) was introduced by way of a specific amendment, anything that is stated in the Schedule 2 will be taxable only if the precondition of 7(1) is satisfied, namely consideration and business. So merely because supply of goods by an unincorporated association is deemed to be a supply of goods does not necessarily lead to the conclusion that there shall be a charge of GST, unless it can be demonstrated that there exists a consideration and just for furtherance of business. Furtherance of business, you can still argue that yes, furtherance of business is possible, because business has been defined to include provision by a club of the facilities or benefits to its member, but consideration cannot be said to be satisfied because there are no two persons. Therefore, under that circumstances, charge of tax will fail and must necessarily fail. Okay. But I want you to think it through, and this is where I'm leaving some seeds of thought. This is my apprehension. I hope people who are participating will take this with a pinch of salt and apply their own thinking cap. If there is anybody from the revenue, I hope they are not, because if there's anybody from the revenue, they may get a sense of apprehension by reading what I'm going to tell now. As all of us are aware, unlike the service tax era or the sales tax era, GST contemplates charge of tax on self-supply. When there is a supply between me and myself, GST contemplates a charge of tax, unlike what used to happen in the erstwhile era. Erstwhile era, supply by a head office to its branch was not liable to sales tax because it was the same legal entity. Erstwhile era, supply of services by the head office to its branch in separate state would not trigger a GST because it was the same legal entity. But can we say under GST, a supply by a head office to his branch is not liable to service GST? The answer is resoundingly no, because there is a specific entry that has been put out in Section 7 to say transactions between related parties and distinct entities, even though not made for a consideration, is a deemed supply. Transactions between related parties and distinct persons, even though not made for a consideration, is still a deemed supply. It essentially therefore means that self-supply without a consideration is liable to tax. And this concept of self-supply without consideration is liable to tax is a unique dimension which did not exist under the erstwhile era. Because on the erstwhile era, what was the pronouncement of the law by the Supreme Court and the English law? That you cannot make a supply to yourself. There cannot be a self-supply because there are no two separate persons and there is no consideration. But when the statute itself says that there will be a self-supply, there will be a tax on a self-supply, even if consideration is missing, then can we say that a self-supply made by the club to its members is immune from taxation? It is not a supply. Can we at all apply Calcutta Club's judgment to bring home a point that even though it may be a supply by the same person, namely the association to its member, there is a commonality of purpose, commonality of objective for which I have come, properties owned by all of them together, yet it is not a supply? Because the deeming provision says, even when the factory head office supplies to his branch, it will be deemed to be a supply. It's the same self-supply that is liable to tax there as well. So if that be the case, if the association or incorporator otherwise is considered to be pegged at the same level as the head office, and the members are pegged at the level as the branch office, why would tax not be applied? Why should tax not be applied? It's a point for all of you to ponder and think it through. The only way tax will not be applied is if we are able to establish that the members are not distinct persons or the members are not related parties. Because This whole concept of deemed supply or self-supply triggers without consideration only when there is a distinct person and a related party. If you are neither, then you escape the tax liability for want of consideration. Now, the question therefore is it possible to contend that the members are not a distinct person? Is it possible to contend that the members are not a related party qua the association? So let's test it. Who is a distinct person? A distinct person is a person of the same legal entity who has taken registration in the other state. Correct? If you are within the same state, that issue does not arise. Correct? Most members that probably go into this members club are probably within the same state or same locality. And probably they may not even be registered. But they may be registered. They may be registered in their independent capacity as lawyer or not lawyers, as chartered accountants or maybe architects or maybe doctors. I don't know whether they need to register or not. They may be independently registered as well for GST purposes. By virtue of being independently registered, do they become a distinct person? What is the remit of distinct person? Does the distinct person need to be with respect to the same business that the parent does? Would a chartered accountant who is a member in a particular club may be registered for purposes of GST for club services, but the chartered accountant is not registered for that purposes. Chartered accountant is registered for purposes of providing chartered accounting services. Even though therefore two may be registered for different purposes, can they be said to be yet a distinct person? How far do you stretch the concept of distinct person insofar as these things are concerned? Is there two different hats that the chartered accountant is wearing? Insofar as being a member is concerned, it is a different side of the chartered accountant. Insofar as registration with the GST is concerned, the chartered accountant is a different person altogether. And therefore, can we say that there is an artificial distinction that can be brought out interstate between the same chartered accountant? One facet of that is qua the membership. Other facet of that is qua the professional services that it renders in an independent capacity, irrespective and notwithstanding being a member of the club. Because his performance as a chartered accountant is not dependent upon being a member of the association. It's a wholly different concept. Therefore, and it's a ticklish question, it will require some amount of thinking, and I just wanted to seed this thought. Therefore, can we say, or should we not examine, whether or not a chartered accountant in this example qualifies as a distinct person? And if it does not qualify as a distinct person, surely the charge of GST cannot apply. But if it does qualify as a GST, or somebody is able to make a point before the judges that he is a distinct person, then probably we have a problem in hand. Assuming that we are able to cover that and we are able to traverse that he is not a distinct person, we need to still deal with the whole aspect of what I call the related party. Because one of the criteria of related party, okay, is that the related party is somebody who is a custodian or an agent. And that's the definition of related party in your GST, in your valuation provision. And I have it in front of you. I'll just read it out for you. Just give me a minute. It says, person who are associated in the business of one another, in that one is the sole agent. Now, earlier in our presentation, I had made a point that 2-3 times the Supreme Court as well as the English courts have said that the association is an agent or a trustee of the member. Association is an agent or a trustee of a member. That's what the Supreme Court had said. I had brought it out earlier. Remember, I have been harping on that point. I'll quickly take you to that slide so that it kind of catches your attention again. Okay. This one. In Young Men's Association itself, Supreme Court had said, this last bullet point, it was held that there could be no sale in the above case since there is no transfer of property from one person to another, since a members club is an agent making available the property belonging to its member. So this is one time Supreme Court had said that his association is essentially an agent. The earlier version of that was the English law, where Tribag, okay, the Supreme Court said, just one sec. Yeah. Following graph and events, the court held that as the members owned the liquor between themselves, there was no actual sale, and the club was simply a trustee or agent of the member. So we have two situations where the English court as well as the Indian court seems to have suggested that the association is essentially an agent of the member. And if that happens, and I were to go back to the definition of related party for purposes of GST, okay, it says persons who are associated in the business of one another, in that one is a sole agent of the other, will qualify as a related party. So we have to cross the hurdle of whether an association can be said to be a related party for the members, even though it may be said to be the same person. Under that circumstances, by virtue of being an agent, will the mutuality test be of any support at all to us? Because today, GST gets charged even without a consideration. And these two exceptions of being an associated enterprise or related party or a distinct person are two thorny things that we need to get over before we can thumb the table and tell the courts that there can be no levy of GST on transactions between an association and its members. Now, the related point that comes out is many firms, many associations have been paying the tax to the government, and probably they may have recovered it from their members as part of their membership. How do we deal with that? We don't know when the audits will happen. We don't know when the jurisprudence will shape up. For those of them who may have gone for the advanced ruling, that is an independent route. For those of you who may not have, I would recommend forthwith file your refund claim under Section 54 within the timeline so prescribed, which is, I think, is 2 years, right? Forthwith file. You will, in all probability, get a rejection. Against the rejection order, you come straight to the High Court. Subject, however, to the fact that the disputed questions of facts are recorded in the rejection order. The rejection order should be so passed as that your contention on the features of your association is very clearly brought out through your written submission. In the rejection order, he should say that notwithstanding all these features being present, in view of the specific nuance of the GST law and in contradistinction to what the Supreme Court may or may not have said in the Calcutta Club's Cup, the authorities believe it is still taxable. Such a finding of law and facts should be undisputedly there in the document. Against that document, come to the writ court. Since all of you are from Calcutta, such a writ will come before the single judge. And then the whole journey will kind of begin. So the point I'm trying to make is that there is nothing in the GST Act that you can use as your cause of action to come to the High Court. Okay? It is not like the rules have traveled beyond the act, or the act has made a discrimination between X and Y, or anything, any perversity that can be, or any irregularity that you can say in the drafting. Nowhere does the law say in so many words that transaction between incorporated or unincorporated with these members will be taxable. Nowhere does it say that. Especially after Section 7(1)(a) has having been introduced, making entry 7 of list 2 merely a classification issue. That's all. So therefore, there is nothing in the statute that comes in your way. What comes in your way is going to be the interpretation of the law, the application of law. That interpretation and application can come only through an assessment order or a refund rejection order. So therefore, invoke such a refund rejection through appropriate speaking order, which records your submission on the factual attributes, which is not disputed by the authorities at all. Against such an order, you come straight to the High Court by way of a writ petition, filing a writ of certiorari and a mandamus, seeking a direction for refund of the taxes that have been there. Now, if you have collected the tax from the members, then obviously the refund will never come to you. Therefore, the member should also be a party respondent in such a writ petition, where we can pray before the court that should the refund be granted, the refund may be granted to respondent number 2 instead of passing it on to the consumer welfare fund. So the members and the associations both should work in cohorts together in tandem. It should not be that the members, you know, members relegate the association to fend for itself, because at the end of the day, members do not have an existence independent that of the association. And if you want to take the mutuality of interest as a, you know, point, then both together should make that application before the court. Otherwise, the petition may not pass the muster of muster of commonality of interest and so on and so forth. So this is all that I had. And I think I have busted my time, about 1.5 hours that was given to me. I am happy to take questions if any one of you may have. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Ghosh, for a very, very nice delivery, I must say. You discussed at length about the principle of mutuality right from the British era till now. Now, floor is open for taking questions. I'll request Rajesh to unmute everyone so that they can ask questions.
People are unmuted. If they want, they can unmute and ask questions.
Sure. Shami, you're there. You can put your question in the chat box or you can ask the question directly to Mr. Ghosh.
Good evening, Mohit this side.
Yes, Mohit.
Sir, just want to know that since at the last deliberation you told that we should proceed for the refund in case of the RWAs. So how it should be in terms that what should be the course of action since we are doing the audits of so many RWA. So how should we proceed and how should we communicate that this is the law and then we should try and have a go so as to claim the GST refund?
So I'm making an assumption that the RWA is not registered with the GST authorities.
It is registered with the GST authority and we are paying the taxes.
So then you file a refund under Section 54 online and you send a letter detailing the reasons why the refund is being claimed. It is very simple.
Despite of the fact that the GST has already been collected from the members.
No, so that's fine. You can say, you can make a, so that's why I said, you. What you do is in your refund application, you say that we have collected it. We have collected it. Therefore, the refund should be made to the following members of the association in respect of the following shares. Because the law is very simple. If there is an unjust enrichment, then the person who has borne the incidence of tax will be eligible for the refund, isn't it?
Absolutely. And 54 also talk about any person.
Correct. So don't worry about that. So therefore you list out all of that, take signatures of all of that and give the bank account details of all of those persons so that there is no doubt or confusion on how the amount should be remitted. Therefore, that letter, that physical letter is very important apart from the online letter. Because see, online letter does not have all those fields. But nothing stops you from giving an offline letter at all.
I want to add one thing more. That since nowadays it's a practice of issuing the deficiency memo and it's a challenge to get the rejection order, then how we should be proceeding that?
See, the point, law is very simple. From the time you file your refund application, they will have to issue a deficiency memo if there is necessity of that. Otherwise, they will not, right? Deficiency memo is issued only if the relevant documents have not been attached. That's all. After deficiency memo, they'll have to issue you a show cause notice if they want to reject it. Okay? That notice will be a single pager. After the notice, they'll have to give you a hearing under 54.9. After the hearing, they will have to pass a rejection order. And the time limit for the rejection order is essentially, it has to be within 60 days from the date the deficiency memo was issued. Because the time runs from the date the deficiency memo was, no, sorry, not deficiency
SCN,
memo.
SCN.
No. From the acknowledgement. Yeah. After the deficiency memo has been issued and you have rectified and they have issued RFD3 or something. From that particular date, the timeline starts. So there is a very well-defined time period that is there. So you have to, see, I'm assuming since you are in the business of filing returns, you have a good rapport with your tax officer. You have to carry him along. You have to humor him and get the order accordingly in that sense. And not then, the contents then, of the order, but at least a rejection, if you will.
Then I will be coming to you. I just understood and will approach you, definitely.
Yeah. Or anybody. I mean, there are other many competent people in this room as well. Absolutely.
Any other questions?
Anybody else wants, they can just unmute themselves.
Sir, I have a question. You talked about principle of commerciality, right? And say our association is receiving contribution from both members and non-members. for participating in, say, our annual conference or various seminars, meetings, study circle meetings. In that case, can we take a stand that we'll pay tax, GST, on contribution from non-members, but in the case of members' contribution, principle of mutuality exists and we won't pay?
Yes, that's perfectly correct, provided you also don't have a situation where the same privileges are being given to the members and the non-members. You have to create some distinction between the two.
So there is a problem there, because if we say that members and non-members both can join our study circle meeting or our annual conference or seminar, how we distinguish between the two?
No, so you have to say that some programs the non-members cannot join. Some exclusivity will have to be created. If, which is what the problem was, that's what the Supreme Court said, if the privileges are identical, then what are you talking about? What mutuality? There has to be some differentiation in class and treatment and privileges between members. And after all, the monies that are being used by the contributions made by the members will have to be of an exclusive nature. It cannot be fungible with non-members. So therefore, that you have to be very careful. You have to amend your charter, which is why I was saying every association may have different set of facts. Let us not generalize it. It is for chartered accountants who are advising them to do an audit of their features and first take a view whether the facts support the mutuality as a concept. Without doing that diligence, let us not jump to the conclusion that Calcutta Club.
So can there be a differentiation here that say we, if we take a position that we'll charge say from non-members say 2,500 rupees for attending our annual conference, but from the members we'll charge 2,000 rupees?
No. The quantum of consideration, quantum of membership may not be the differentiator, but the privileges. After all, look at it this way. What was the purpose why the members paid? For the privileges, for the benefits. That's the reciprocal thing, right? That's the purpose. If in that there is no differentiation between member and non-member, then you're actually, hitting at the root of the substance.
Okay.
One question, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Sujitda. So question is that in Calcutta, many of the societies are registered and that they are rendering the charitable services. Mm. Charitable services. They render the services to the members as well as to the public members without any creed and caste. Mm. For that, they are charging some charges for the supposed renting of a hall for wedding purposes. Mm. If the member of the society takes the book the hall, the same rate is charged and public are booking, the same rates are charged. Are we there? They should take the registration under GST Act.
For the non-members, for sure.
Yes, any public member then come, they can get it.
Yes. Of course.
They are the charitable institution.
The point is very clear. For anything that you are recovering from non-members, you have a charge.
Yes, sir.
But the point I was telling Mr. Agarwal was that by virtue of admitting non-members, please make sure that the level of privileges are not identical.
That is correct. Sometimes they organize programs for the members in which the public cannot participate.
That distinction is there. Then the members part should not be liable to tax. The non-members part will be liable to tax.
That means yes, it should take the
risk. Yes.
Uh-huh. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Sirindaji.
Ankit, you have any question?
Section 8 companies. Somebody has asked a question. Does mutuality apply to Section 8 companies? Same concept. Section 8 company is the same. Purpose of Section 8 companies, non-profit, all of those things. So, like I said, at the first slide of mine was that it doesn't matter what is the modus of the legal entity, whether it is registered under the society, whether it's under trust deed, whether it's an association of that kind, or a Section 8 company. It really doesn't matter. What matters is the substance. Have you come together for a common purpose? Have you contributed? Do you have ownership over the contribution? Are you doing it for yourself? Those are the features and not the legal entity. Good. I think there aren't any. We can close the day then.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, more questions are there. Are there any? No, or Queenie, or Queenie, big more questions. Yeah, it was a very nice delivation, Mr. Sujit. Thank you very much, sir. You start talking about the principle of maturity right from the British era and discussed at length in the Indian context. And the two principles which you rightly said, the principle of commerciality and common identity, that needs to be looked into. Particularly in the GST era, the point which you have raised, that though it is covered under the definition of business, but the constitutional powers need to look into, and the principle of maturity arises there. But when in the last slide, when you talked about section 7-1D, then the issue arises, right? We need to think about the distinct person and related person. There the problem arises, sir. Because if in the same state we chartered accountants, we are also registered, our association is also registered. So that issue will be there, and you raised a very pertinent issue, sir. Thank you very much. Now I'll request our secretary, Ms. Rajesh Agarwal, to offer a formal comments.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of DTP and myself, I thank Sri Sujit Ghoshji, Advocate Supreme Court, for giving a wonderful deliberation. I thank all the participants, our past presidents, and the office bearer of the association for joining the webinar. I thank Shyam Agarwal, the IT Chairman Committee, for making this a nice arrangement. Thanks to all.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks to everyone, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Good thank day. You, have a nice
thank
weekend.
You, sir. Thank you, sir.
Rita, thank you. An excellent deliberation.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you,
thanks
Sandeep.
Also thank you. Goes to, thanks also goes to Mr. Sandeep Chaudhary for organizing such a nice.
Thank you, Sandeep ji. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Rita, you left nothing to be asked.
Yeah, that was true. That was true.
That is the problem. It was so crystal clear that nothing was left to be asked.
That's true.
चलिए bye bye.
Thank you, Dada.
Thank you. Thank
bye
you.
Bye bye.
देखा होगा.
हाँ निश्चय निश्चय. Sure.
Dada bye bye.
Thank you very much.
Bye.